Is there something to how hard you guys actually had to work to get this win about the character and maybe what can do for the group here?
Yeah, you know, like before the game we talked, we loved their second half against Boston. And especially the last 6-7 minutes of the second, the third period. And, you know, it's hard to do, but our goal was to try and come out and play that way to that identity. Because for the guys that hadn't been here, like, that is the identity of our team. Like, so try and sustain it for as long and as hard as we possibly can. And it certainly, it did not come easy. I thought their team blocked a lot of shots. They got shooting lanes. They kind of pack it in front of the net a little bit. And their goalie made some huge saves, right? And so we had to work for it. Even at the end, you know, you finally take the lead and they guys are laying out, desperation, great commitment to try and keep the puck out of our net, and they get another one to tie it. But kept playing, had a good overtime, had some good chances. So you got to be happy with not only the effort and the determination that they played with, but to be able to sustain it as long as they did and to just stick with it regardless of the score. It's a great effort, you know. And sometimes you lose games like that, but it's I'm proud of them for sticking with it and getting that first one, and hopefully we keep working like that. Maybe some wins will come a little bit easier.
How much of a relief is this?
Well, here's the thing. It's like you don't want to drop too many because it just, you know, we know how hard it's going to be to climb out of that hole. So it is a relief. More importantly, I think, than relief, it's looking past that. It's the guys getting rewarded finally for, like, playing the right way. Because the Boston game, we did a lot of good things. I think we deserved a better fate in 1 and 2. It's game 3 I didn't like. But you start looking at how many, like, really good periods you played and how many chances you have and what you're giving up. And to be 0-4 really stings. And 0-5 would be that much worse, especially when you're playing that hard and playing the right way as a group and staying positive. It gets tough to stay positive if you don't ever get results. So that'll go a long way because it's stacked on top of 2 pretty good periods against Boston and now, 3 good ones again tonight. So you got to keep going.
Nick, go ahead, Nick.
Thanks. To further your first answer, is this a game that you'll come back and look on and point to maybe if you get into a bit of a rough stretch again because of the way that you guys battled the entire time? You overcome 2 goals that, not necessarily anybody's fault at the start of that, and then you'll look back and say, man, boys, remember when we were in the doldrums and this came back? Was that something you've drawn?
Yeah, I think what we try to do is keep pushing the bar on what we think is as good as we can play, right? And so Boston third period was the best we played the whole year. And then when we break it down and show it to them and teach them exactly why we think it was so good and what sort of fuels that in our team, so everyone gets clear on it so they're not guessing at all. It's not just we had a good period. Like, you got to break it down, show them, and explain what we think is really important. You take some input. Everyone kind of has a conversation. And then you go and try to repeat it tonight, you know. There may be little different things that you want to do against Anaheim from Boston, but that was work-based, competitive, relentless hockey. And when you're doing that, then you're going to have your fair share of success. So, you know, now tonight we sustained it much longer than we did against Boston, so that becomes the new bar, and they'll see it again, and then we'll try and, like, better that performance, and you just kind of keep going and trying to push that bar higher and higher.
What was the explanation on the second goal from the officials, and at that point, what was sort of going through your mind when those are the 2 goals that make it 2-0?
Well, I was mad, and not necessarily at the official originally. I was mad that we quit playing. Because we have the puck, full control. There's 1 guy in the zone. We've got 3 or 4 in the zone. The whistle doesn't go. You got to keep playing. You can't just throw it back to him and then give up a goal late in the period. Like, that was not a good play, okay? But in G's defense, puck's out of play. And the ref is like, going to blow the whistle, he's pointing, he's going to blow the whistle, he's pointing. Like, all if he didn't see it go out, which that's fine, then you can just yell, like, play or, like, no, and, like, just then the guys know. But when you're starting to go like this and you're – it's kind of – it's deceiving. I think G thinks he's going to blow it once and doesn't and thinks he's going to blow it again. So it was – he – the official knew he made a mistake. He apologized for the indecision. He didn't want to guess, and you can't guess. If you don't see it go out, you can't just blow it and assume it went out, right? But for us, we got to keep playing. We knew it went out. We have video that went out. But as soon as the puck crosses the blue line and goes in the neutral zone, it's not a challengeable call. If it stayed in the zone they put in the net, we challenge it, and it's no good. That wasn't the case, so we go from there. And you got to. It's a good lesson, you know, that you got to play every play like it's the most important play of the game. That's what we guys tried to do tonight, and probably besides that one, we played hard. You know, as hard as we could.
Jared, last year whenever we asked you about shifting Colton to the wing, you referenced lack of center depth. Yeah. I guess two-parter. Number one, what does Casey Mittelstadt do for that center depth? And number two, what makes Colton so good on the wing, especially with like what he did in Tampa with skilled guys like McKinnon and Mikko?
Yeah, it's – well, when you add Casey in there, right, and then Kelly in there, and like we're rolling three lines a lot. We're getting the fourth line involved a little bit and bouncing some guys around just to get them some minutes and take some minutes and keep contributing as a team of 12. Obviously, the heat's turned up on us right now, so we weren't using our fourth line as much as we would because it's desperation. We've got to win. But when you start adding players in the middle of the ice, like Colton's – part of Colton's game, which makes him really good, is as a winger, is he likes to skate and move and keep a little momentum, and then he's a terrific forechecker, physical. Like, he can get on the hunt more. When you play goal line to goal line, so if you have to go back and help our D all the time and you're stopped down there in the battles, it's the wingers that are taking off and doing that skating, right? And you got to work to try and keep up with them, and then you're often F3 in the offensive zone. Well, Colts is part of his strength is being F1 or F2 and hunting the puck down and checking it back, right? He has the hands and shot, you know, playing with some playmakers. He's obviously a guy that likes to shoot it and likes to go to the net hard. He has some of those characteristics, like I talked about the other day, of Landy, Lecky, Val, the guys that have had success with Mac and Mikko, because he goes to the paint when they get the puck and they protect it and they're skating and making plays in the offensive zone. So there's a lot of things that he does that complement Mac and Mikko. It's just tougher to do some of the things that he does best when you're playing center. He's still, like, he's grown as a centerman too, but we just, you know, if you don't have enough guys that can play down the middle, you still want all your top players playing together. So that may mean he moves to the back to center at some point too, when we get a bunch of wingers back.
Coach, so you know, we talked about the second goal. That first one that goes in, there's a lot of guys on the ice who seemed that, you know, thought that maybe it was just slow whistle. Was this maybe the first time you saw the group channel that frustration in the right way? It seemed like coming out of that second goal, there was a little extra step in there.
The first goal, are you talking about?
First goal against, yeah.
Yeah, so, well, here's the thing. He shoots it, he saves it, it's under his pad. He waits, he freezes, waiting for a whistle, because I think he thinks it's under his pad. And to me, blow it. When he doesn't hear the whistle, he gets up and it pops free, and now it's behind him, and then we can't put our hands on it, we can't do anything. So, like, you saw the replay, Manson's holding it against Gorgie's pad, but until it's covered, no whistle's going to go. Flip side, if you look at the second period, we have a low attack, hits their goalie's pad, it's sitting on his pad, then it's underneath Mitty, and as soon as they lose sight of it, it's like, tweet, whistle's gone. It's loose in front of the net when we're jamming away. So if you lose sight of the puck and that's your rule and you don't know where it is and blow it, you can't convince me that puck was not covered, because it was for at least a 1-2 count, you know? So, like, those things, when you're losing, some of those things go against you. I'm not blaming the officials on them, but I think there, you know, lots of nights that just is a big save, and it's done. So it was a little unlucky for us, unlucky for Gorgie, but I'm proud of him the way he worked through that. It wasn't a busy night, but he made big saves when he needed to, and he got us a win. That's the most important thing at this point.